1944 was my privilege to found jazz at the Philharmonic. No one would have guessed at that time, least of all myself, the extent to which these concerts would grow. It's been a fabulous experience. It's been my life. At that first concert of jazz greats, our piano soloist was Nat King Cole.
Thank you very much, Norman. You know, I'd like to let our listeners know before we begin that this is the first television appearance of Jazz at the Philharmonic, and that just last Wednesday, you completed your 18th annual tour of presenting concerts all over the world, great cities all over the world. That's right, huh?
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Nat King Cole and Norman Granz in 1957. That year saw the last annual U.S. tour of Jazz at the Philharmonic. 13 years had passed since the first concert. Over those years, Norman Granz had built a unique and enormously successful operation. I'm Nat Hentoff, and tonight on Out of the Norm, the focus is on JATP and the recording activities that began with the Clef label, formed in 1946. Norman Granz once gave three reasons for utilizing jazz as his initial springboard.
One was, I felt that jazz could be used as a sociological weapon in terms of fighting discrimination. The other was that I liked jazz and I liked the idea of presenting jazz. And third, I enjoyed the idea of making money, and it does that.
By the late 40s, Granz, using those points of reference, had become a serious triple threat. Jazz historian and broadcaster Bob Porter.
In most of the cities that he visited, the coming to town of Jazz at the Philharmonic was a huge social event in the black community. And going to, you know, a Jazz at the Philharmonic concert was like going to the Grammy Awards or something like that. It was a big deal. Anybody who was anybody in that community was going to that concert.
The first concert I recorded was the one which subsequently appeared as Volume 4, the one with Nat Cole and Les Paul. An Illinois Jacket. That was the first one that I had actually thought of putting out. But I think it was 6 months later, in another concert, I did the How High the Moon album, and that was with Krupa and Ventura and McGee and Joe Guy and people like that. And I don't know why, I just thought that that was a better one to come out with first.
Trumpeter Joe Guy, soloing on How High the Moon, recorded in Los Angeles on the 12th of February, 1945, and released on the Ash label the following year.
I think the real national success of Jazz at the Philharmonic really could be attributed to the time that Ella joined the tour, because Ella gave it suddenly a much broader base of appeal by people who knew her as a jazz hyphen pop singer of the day.
Hey. As I walk down the street, seems everyone I meet gives me a friendly hello. Birds in every tree are also neighborly. They sing wherever I go. I guess I'm just a lucky so, and so. If you should ask me the amount in my bank account, I'd have to admit that I'm slipping. But that don't worry me. Confidentially, I've got a dream that's a pippin. And when the day is through, each night I hurry to a home where love waits. I know
Ella Fitzgerald sings Duke Ellington at a JATP concert on the 18th of September, 1949, at New York's Carnegie Hall. Backing Ella was her then husband, bassist Ray Brown, plus pianist Hank Jones and drummer Buddy Rich. Ella had made her JATP debut 6 months earlier. Another Granz first also occurred in 1949, during that September 18th JATP concert.
Norman came to town to promote a concert that he had coming up in Montreal, and he was doing advanced publicity on it. And I was performing at the Alberta Lounge, and he was on his way to the airport, and it was the night that we broadcast from the lounge, that's what happened. And the cabbie had his radio on, and Norman heard the group, and fine, turn the cab around. This sounds like Norman, turn the cab around. And came down to the lounge, and during performing of whatever tune, I looked down and saw these saddle shoes, and I still remember as my eyesight following up the legs, seeing the tweed outfit he had on. He was very English at that time, and the next thing I spotted was the face with the eyebrows. And when the set was over, we went down to say hello because I thought I had to, because I wanted to tell him how much his music and his records had meant to me over the years. And he talked to me, he said, "You ever thought about coming to the States?" And I said, "Oh, I don't think so." And he said, "Come and do a concert with us at Carnegie." Of course, I said to myself, "Carnegie?" He said, "Think about it." And he said, "I'll be in touch with you." And he called me, and I agreed to do it. And I went down to Carnegie.
Twenty-four-year-old Oscar Peterson, being thrown in at the deep end by Norman Granz. Given that the JATP troops that night included such heavyweights as Lester Young, Coleman Hawkins, Roy Eldridge, and Charlie Parker, as well as Ella, the pianist showed no sign of nerves as he romped through that blues with just Ray Brown for company. It was an auspicious start to a memorable career. I'm Nat Hentoff with Out of the Norm, the life and times of Norman Granz on BBC Radio 2.